Let me tell you something. When you have a duly elected president that's elected by the people, you don't have barbed wire and razor wire and fences. You know where you have that? Caracas. That's where you have that, right?
That's right.
Cuba. That's where you have that, right? Yep. Disgusting. And I'm not going to. Anyway, let's move on. Welcome back, everybody, to the Financial Guys podcast. Welcome back. I mean, you know you're here, right? It's not like obviously you stumbled across us, right?
You know
where
you are.
You know where you are, right? It's not like you specifically went and either watched our YouTube video or you downloading this on an iTunes app or Spotify or something like that. But we're, again, 22 years of radio, we're just so used to
take it out of our blood,
right? People coming back after tuning in from other things. Anyway, this is the Financial Guys podcast. Glenn Wiggle, Mike Lomas, been doing this now for 2 years, been doing radio for 22 years. For those that are just tuning in, this is a place where money meets politics, and we're going to talk some COVID numbers again today. I know that's a shocker to most of you. We're also going to talk about some markets a little bit. I do want to talk, Mike, about where we're at with this new economic policy, which is just fake. I don't know how else to put it. I mean, maybe we should actually start there. I mean, I love, first of all, these politicians, they're not economists. They're not financial analysts. They're not, economic financial experts. People like Paul Krugman are dumber than dirt. I mean, let's be honest. He's out there advocating for higher minimum wage. Everybody with a brain in their head knows that's honest about it, that that's not going to be helpful, right?
Did you hear, by the way, one of the politicians, and I've got it here somewhere in California, said, yeah, that's okay. Or here he goes. Yeah. Democrat Representative Ro Khanna, we don't want low-wage small businesses that pay less than $15 in our state.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, guess what, Ro?
Says the elite, right?
Yeah.
Says the elitist who's getting paid by the taxpayers,
by the taxpayers, right?
Why don't you ask the kids who need those jobs?
We don't want any small business owners in California. Okay, bye.
You know what? Here's the thing. Like, honestly, like a small business like ours, we don't pay anybody less than $15 an hour, right? Because the job market is competitive enough to where, we're a professional organization and we need to pay up to get the proper talent, right?
Well, and we've been in it long enough. When we first started, we didn't have the resources to do that.
Well, of course.
We didn't have the resources.
No, we didn't. And we paid minimum wage when we had to. Right. And certain jobs, like, okay, you're going to come in and you're going to be the receptionist. Okay, that's not a $50,000 starting position. Like, it's just not.
Right.
Unless you're in, like, Manhattan or something, right? But the fact is they've created now this modern monetary policy, which is a total farce, folks, okay? Modern monetary policy is we can spend whatever we want, and no one's going to ever call the debt. So let me just run this by you from a personal household standpoint. That's like saying, use your credit cards and take out all the debt you want. As long as you're never forced to pay it back, what harm could it do?
Can I tell you why? And I'll tell you the number one reason is because Democrats are listening to academics. Academics have never really played football. I could tell you how to run a play, but could I actually step on an NFL field and play? Well, that's a bad example.
Well, bad example.
I probably could be a wide receiver in the NFL. I chose to be here. But my point is that these academics have never run a business. The movie Back to School had a lot of truth to it, right?
Yep.
Like there's all kinds of things that happen in a business that you cannot put into a book. Yeah. Right. You can't say, okay, hey, just so you know, here's exactly the model to own a restaurant. And then, oh, by the way, when COVID happens and the government tells you you're not allowed to open, here's what you're supposed to do, right? Oh, by the way, when a tornado hits or when the economic crisis hits, and there's unless you actually run a business, it is impossible. And that's why many of these academics end up poor, because they have no clue once they walk out of that university how to actually live or prepare or run a business.
I'm not even sure, though. I think this came from Dick Cheney. I mean, I think this is the Bush, Cheney, according to Rand Paul.
Republicans.
I love Rand Paul.
Sorry about that. I said Democrats. Democrats and half the Republican Party are listening to these academics. These are the same academics that came up with the COVID model that were 96% off, right?
That's right.
But they listen to these academics about, oh, well, if you just do this, then this will happen. Well, that's not how it works. And if they would just spend some time talking to small and medium-sized business owners, and by the way, they profess to help these people. They say they're going to help them. But those are the ones that get crushed, right? They increase the capital gains and play with that a little bit. They'll increase the corporate tax and play with it a little bit.
Well, here's what they're talking about.
Think about this. If you're a very wealthy, wealthy liberal, and you're living on corporate taxes and capital gains, your rate is not nearly as high as if you are a small business owner taking out ordinary income. Now, I'm not saying that so they go increase the tax rates on corporations, because I think that's the worst thing they can do. But when you're a small business owner and you've worked your entire life to try to make it, you finally make it, and now you find yourself in a 50% tax bracket when you live in a communist state like New York,
yeah.
It is impossible to get ahead almost, right? I mean, really, truly, you say to yourself, why am I doing all this? I finally made it. Now you're going to take half my money?
So you got this lady in California saying, we don't want minimum wage jobs. Maybe you should ask those kids coming out of college that want to actually get their foot in the door. Maybe you should ask some of the minority communities, because we know that the elimination of minimum wage jobs affects those folks in the minority community the most, because unfortunately, they have failing schools, and they come out of schools with a third grade math and English level, right?
Yep.
So, you know, now, by the way, and I want me to jump around, I want to get back to modern monetary policy, but in Seattle, math is racist. We'll get to that, so hold that thought. But this modern monetary policy is extraordinarily dangerous because, as we all know, it's going to lead to inflation, right? So we've been talking about this forever. Here's the Democrats' plan, though, to combat inflation, right? Not higher interest rates. They're going to control demand. How are they going to control demand? So remember, inflation is an imbalance between supply and demand. It's too many dollars chasing too few goods. We have not had inflation in this country, although we have pockets of things going up in price. But part of the reason we haven't had wild, out-of-control inflation across the board on everything, for a couple of reasons. Number one, energy prices, because of our exploratory stance, remain low. And energy prices are a big driver of inflation. That's going to change now.
Although they have been going up over the last month.
Well, that's going to change now, right? So that's we're a different stance on that now. But the other reason is that supply has been able to keep up with demand, right? Because of supply-side economics, and I don't care what you want to call it, trickle-down, supply-side theory, whatever it is. But the fact of the matter is, when you lower capital gain or corporate tax rates, as you mentioned, Mike, you're incentivizing the producers to produce. When producers produce, they have more supply. More supply with same demand means lower prices, right? Their idea to affect demand is to just raise everybody's interest rate. Take their money away. Seriously. Right. That's what they're talking about, Mike. They're talking about, okay, well, if we get to inflation, no problem. We'll control inflation through taxation.
Right.
Not through the Fed and monetary policy like normally. In normal times, when inflation gets out of the control, the job of the Fed is to rein in the money supply, lower the money supply, less money in circulation, and that helps to tamp down inflation. They're talking about here going directly to consumers saying, we'll just go to 50%, 60%, 80% tax rates. No one will have any money. Well, they won't be able to chase those.
Don't forget the folks. That's a disaster. This party is still Obama, right? He's still, you know,
clearly. Well, it's not Biden. We know that.
Yeah, and you remember he said, "Look, you didn't build that. So that's not your money. You didn't build that. Somebody else.
Well, it won't be your money soon.
Somebody
else. That's their plan.
Yeah.
Well, that's their plan. It won't be their money soon because that's their plan. Is their
plan. Now you still have the Republican Party, who still is not even focused on, you know, making the elections fair, which they have the ability to do. So.
Yep, they're MIA. They're fighting between Mitch McConnell and Donald Trump. And I got to tell you, Mitch, you're definitely going to lose that battle.
Oh, yeah, no doubt.
Definitely going to lose.
Let's hope. We need a resurgence of Trump because we need a resurgence back to freedom, or at least the attempt to try to make a move back there.
I got to throw a Rand Paul clip in here.
Free money for everyone, they cry.
But that's honest to God. He nails it, right? That's what they want. You know, why not $30,000 a year? Why not 40? Why not 50? Oh, yeah.
Well, they've run on that platform, right?
Yeah, well, that's what they have.
Let's give everybody checks.
That's what they want.
No big deal, right?
It's terrible.
Well, we've tried that. It's called welfare. It's been a broken
how's
system
that working?
Since day one. Yeah.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah. Well, the only thing it's done is made more people poor. That's it. More people poor. The gap between the poor and the rich got wider. Not better. But those are facts. Why be?
Yeah, no, we don't. We can't have that. One more thing before we get on to COVID here, because I know that's going to consume a good chunk of this podcast. This is wonderful. This is just, you know, Democrats just don't get it. They just don't get cause and effect. This out of the Times Union paper in Albany, closing of two Walgreens raise pharmacy desert concerns. Albany, two Walgreens stores closed last Friday afternoon, one on North Pearl Street and one in Menin's. Patients' prescriptions are being sent to neighboring locations. The blue signs posted outside the stores read, but for many patients and former employees, the closure is not that simple. I feel miserable. The store closing and I don't have a job, one employee at North Pearl location said. Now, guess what? So, of course, the mayor, right, of Albany, Mayor Kathy Sheehan, has basically created a disaster, right? I mean, you've got Antifa in Albany, you got Antifa in Rochester,
That's
you've got lockdowns, closures, right? of course, they create the problem, and now they want to have the fix.
This was
right?
a very simple call, but of course, we called this months ago that this would happen with some of these inner cities as the Black Lives Matter group started to target and smash their windows.
So here's what she says. This is great, right? So this is creating a healthcare desert and a vaccination desert, said Albany Mayor Kathy Sheehan. Many people rely on their pharmacies for healthcare, for getting the flu vaccine, for being able to talk to a pharmacist about concerns or questions they have with respect to conditions or medications. And this, again, negatively impacting a neighborhood that is predominantly made up of African Americans. Well, there you have it. Walgreens, you're racist. You're racist. I'm sure it has nothing to do with the fact that your windows were smashed in
your product was stolen.
Right? Or the fact that you can't even open your place, right? Let's see.
Right.
If I'm a Walgreens and I'm like, let's see here. I got to close a couple of stores because, well, they're locked down, like economic times, right? Where do I close them? Palm Beach, Florida, where we have a whole bunch of seniors and everything is open? Or in Albany, where they're smashing my windows and I can only open between the hours of 2 and 3:30? I mean, come on.
And as a publicly traded company, I think Walgreens is publicly traded.
It is.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So as a publicly traded company, we need to grow for the shareholders. Let's see. Where would we set up a new location? Would we set it up in Florida in a town that's not going to burn our Walgreens down, that's led by a governor that says if you come in, we can actually stop you? Or do we rebuild that location that you just burned down? Let me think about that. But they don't get it, Glenn. They just don't get it. You'd think at some point they'd figure this stuff out. They don't.
And hats off to the Times Union for spending, I don't know how many pages talking about all the negative impacts, but never talking about the actual reason why they're closing.
Never once.
It's just the whole article is about how this disproportionately affects Black and Brown Americans.
Yep, they'll try to put heat on Walgreens to open up. It'll be redistricting.
Well,
it'll be redlining for pharmacies and for Rite Aids and Walgreens. That's what it'll be. The next step will be: if you want to open Walgreens in a nice suburb, then you have to open here. I know they smashed your windows. I know they took all your stuff. But to what? That's the loss leader you're going to have to put up with.
Yep.
And remember, that never caused a banking. Oh, wait, it did cause a banking crisis. Sorry. Yeah, that redlining actually smashed the entire banking system. But it won't do that to Walgreens and Rite Aid. Nah.
Well, she is aggressively anti-police, the Albany mayor is, right? Less police, cutting budgets, less safety, more damage, more riots, more theft in those communities.
You can't figure out
businesses, right?
Why there's no businesses there.
Right.
You just can't figure it out. Yep. Going on that theme, by the way, did you see Biden? He wants to change, let me see if I have it here. He wants the next round of stimulus.
Yes, to go to predominantly Black businesses.
Here's what I don't understand. And again, when you Black folks, when is the Black community going to step up and say we have had enough of the insults by the Democrats?
Seriously.
Party, right? Biden has said you don't even know how to, first of all, you can't figure out how to get an identification to vote if you need an ID to vote.
Right.
He said you don't know how to use the internet, right? So you can't, there's no possible way you could find out where to vote or how to where to go or all that stuff. It's just insult after insult after insult. Yep. And let me see if I have that here.
It's amazing. I mean, he basically said, the way the PPP loans were set out, you had to go through your bank. A lot of African Americans, the minority communities don't know how to use the internet and can't get on to apply for these loans.
Yeah.
But how insulting is that? Somebody put out a meme, by the way. Not a meme, but a video.
It was hilarious.
That was so well done. I mean, thank God.
It was a Black gentleman who was acting like a caveman. And he had this computer and he's trying to open it and he's crawling around it. And
it was absolutely hilarious.
Yeah. But anyways, on the PPP loan, there is absolutely no place that says what is the color of your skin. That no place. So ultimately, what Joe Biden is saying is if you're a Black small business owner, you're not smart enough to go to the bank and fill out the paperwork. That's what he said.
That's right.
We have to do it for you. We have to go into your community and say,
stuff money in your pockets.
I mean, how insulting is that?
It's amazing.
I can't imagine. If I was a Black person and I owned a business, how pissed off I'd be.
Well, I mean, honest to God, I mean, it's so insulting. We'll play that clip. It's just really unbelievable. It really is. I'll have to find it.
So how are you going to use PPP to stimulate by the way, many of these, there's a problem, Joe, in the east side of Buffalo, I'll use as an example. There's not enough businesses there. There's not enough people who are asking for small business loans because there's no businesses there, Joe.
Right.
And there's not going to be many businesses there until you actually fix the school systems. So these kids come out, and can read at a 12th grade level. They're prepared for college or an educational training something, whether that's plumbing or electricity or carpentry or whatever it is they want to do. But until we actually fix the school systems that are run by liberal Democrats,
are
run by unions that are liberal Democrats, you can do all the PPP loans you want on the east side of Buffalo or the inner city of Rochester or wherever it is. They're not going to do jack you know what. Nothing. Nothing. Yep. It'll be wasted money. It'll be like the Buffalo Municipal Housing Authority.
Right.
By the way, those houses are still there. Remember?
Paladino was going
to Carl wanted to buy everything for a buck. He was going to, but he was going to invest $10 million of his own money to level those things, which are crack houses. Yep. Nobody lives there anymore. Yep. And they said, no, you can't do that. Carl might make money. Well, God forbid he lose $10 million, but
nobody makes money. So nobody makes money. Yeah,
nobody makes money.
Because
it still looks crack infested. Yeah. And the neighbors look.
Nothing's been done because businessmen like Carl want to risk their money for no potential profit, right? Mm-hmm. As if profit's some sort of a bad thing, unless you're a Democrat, which is fine.
And by the way, looking at the numbers, I don't think it would have been a big profit for Carl. It would have been hey, I'm going to clear this stuff out because it's rat infested, disgusting. Right. It's an eyesore to Buffalo.
Yeah, it'll help the city in general, which will help the other properties. Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Yep,
let me play this. I found the clip, Mike. This is hilarious. Obviously, if you're listening, you're only going to hear the clip, but I would encourage you to go watch the video on our we'll put this video, embed this in our
which
YouTube
feed.
This is the one where the whoever did this video is brilliant. It's a TikTok, and I can't quite see the guy's name on here. It's like Rain.
He's hilarious.
This was very well done, and the comedy is not. I see stuff like this, thinking to myself, "Thank God, comedy is not completely dead." Of course, you can never get away with this.
By the way,
what's that?
Well, I was talking to Kelsey. We need to post that on our Facebook page. That's too good not to.
It is, yeah. Let me play this because you'll hear the audio. You'll get the point of what Joe said. If you missed it, I mean, it's really amazing the fact that Biden and the Democrats get away with making ignorant statements like this, and African American community is not just outraged. I mean, especially the leadership. Like, come on, like Maxine Waters. We can't use the internet. I mean, wouldn't you stand up for your own community and say, wait a minute, now that's pretty insulting, right? But no, they don't.
No.
A lot of people don't know how to register. Not everybody in the community, the Hispanic and the African-American community, particularly in rural areas that are distant and or inner city districts, know how to get online to determine how to get in line for that COVID vaccine.
Oh, my.
I mean, seriously. Seriously.
Holy cow.
It's almost, I love it. We talked with
this is
the radio
who you're
show.
Voting for, though.
Yeah.
I mean, Trump wins that vote. And what did he get, like 12%? I mean, that was a record-breaking vote for a Republican, and he got like 12%. Well,
Trump got more
we're
votes.
Not exactly sure what number he got.
I think it was more than that, actually. Trump got the highest Latino and African-American vote percentage in 50 years for the Republican Party.
How does he not get 80% of that vote?
He wins.
Honestly, God.
But he wins. We talked about this, Mike.
With
just 5 to 10% of the African-American vote, it's over. Trump walks into office. He did. He did. He won by probably 8 to 10 million votes, right? This is such a sham. Biden is an illegitimate president. And obviously, there's a reason, folks, why there's still barbed wire and fences around the Capitol and the White House, right?
Yes.
It's not.
Oh, they got a wall there. Oh.
They have a wall there, right.
Nice tall wall.
They have a wall there.
Nancy Pelosi built
a sweet
wall.
Let me tell you something. When you have a duly elected president that's elected by the people, you don't have barbed wire and razor wire and fences. You know where you have that? Caracas. That's where you have that, right?
That's right.
Cuba. That's where you have that, right? Yep. Disgusting, and I'm not going to. Anyway, let's move on. Let's talk about Mr. Cuomo here, because there's some humdingers here as well. Before I do that, though, actually, Cuomo might actually have to resign. I got to be honest.
I think
I'm going to make this call right
God
now.
God bless you for being optimistic.
I'm going to make this call right now. Cuomo resigns by the end of this year.
He doesn't.
I think you're going to be right, but I'm going to put this call out there and hope that I'm right. Because
I hope you're right, too.
Now I'm seeing the reason. Here's why I say this.
I'll bet you a beer in our Jupiter office.
No, here's why. I'm starting to see liberal publications and liberal media outlets like the New York Times and Newsweek are starting to come out against a Governor Cuomo. That's what it takes. If the media would all get together and actually do honest reporting to hold Governor Cuomo accountable for the thousands and thousands of deaths that he caused, he would be gone. But this is on a Newsweek, and this is surprising. This is an opinion piece by Ron Kim. He's a New York State Assembly for the 40th District. Yep. By now, much of the world has seen New York's Emmy Award-winning Governor Governor COVID-19 hero Andrew Cuomo come under fire for New York's growing nursing home scandal. March 25th directive, blah, 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 blah. So he's calling these actions, which Cuomo aide Melissa DeRosa admitted to on a call, blah, 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 blah. Basically, what he's saying is between the budget fiasco, the March 25th, the get out of jail free, you know, all the garbage is going to add up to a point where he's going to be forced to resign. I don't think this is actually going away. I think what's going to happen is Cuomo is creating such bad press for the Democrats. I think what you're going to see is you're going to probably end up seeing somebody in the higher ups of the party, whether it be Obama or it be whoever, saying, you know what, you got to step down. We'll give you a nice cushy position. We'll make you the attorney general after this next, you know, lunatic goes, you know, Merrick Garland, you know, and that'll be your position. I think they're going to pressure him to resign. I really do. I don't think this is going away.
I think it starts to fade away. I think it starts to fade away. Here's why. Because he knows that. He knows that most of the Democrat Party fears him, and he will just wait it out. And I'll use Buffalo as an example. 247, I assure you, they're more focused on Ted Cruz taking a vacation.
Oh, of course they are.
Than they are this guy killing thousands and thousands of people by shoving him in a nursing home, right? I mean, that should be that. You think about what he did and the stupidity of that, which we've been talking about for months. This is not new, months. That should be every time you turn on the TV, every time you
every
look
time.
At
it. That's all it should
time.
Be. Wall-to-wall coverage.
It's starting to fade out. Wall-to-wall
coverage.
I wish you were right, but there is no hope for this the state of New York. It is heading towards California. California is a mess. I think 17% of the population is now homeless there.
Yeah, that's crazy.
It has turned into a third world country. And New York is fighting its way to that just as fast as it possibly can. Now, the reason I don't think you'll see as many homeless in New York as you do in California is because they'll start to force their way out because of the cold, right?
Right.
There's too many nice places in California where you can hang out and build a tent and, you know, not die of being frozen solid. But there you will see the gap between the rich and the poor. I mean, think about how many financial advisors. We've got a pretty big office here in Western Europe. How many financial advisors have left in the last 12 to 24 months, right? There's going to be few financial advisors left. There will be some restaurants that make it very successfully out of this mess. But I can tell you where I live, 60% of them are gone out of business, right? There's not too many options. There's not. Now, the one option that's left is a restaurant called Bravo. I love Bravo. I love the people there. They're great. So that's good. That's a restaurant that survived, and I would encourage you to go there if you're listening in the Alma, New York area. But still, the gap between the rich and the poor will get wider than ever in those states. I just don't see them going. I just don't see them. They haven't even taken his power away, Glenn.
I know. It's sickening.
And that would be the first step, right? There's so much pressure on these Democrats that they would say, let's at least take power
back.
They haven't done that.
But here's what I'm thinking, okay? So you have a handful of Democrats now, maybe about a dozen or more, that have stood up to Governor Cuomo. Now that they have stood up and spoken out, they are going to have to fight for their lives, right?
Yeah.
They are going to be, as Cuomo said himself, I will destroy you, right?
Yeah.
So so basically now you have a bunch of Democrats that have put their political careers on the line to call out Governor Cuomo. And if they don't win and get him out, then they themselves will lose their positions and any future in the Democrat Party they have. So now you're starting to create this battle within the Democrat Party of those that know Cuomo did a horrible thing and don't want to see their political careers go down the toilet, but they're not going to be able to sit on their hands forever. And now that you have that, what will happen is it'll grow.
Yep.
I'm hoping. You now have the more people that stand up, the more people willing to stand up. Look what we did. Look what Robbie did, right? It took Robbie's gym and Mike and Glenn and Stefan Mihailu and a handful of business owners to raise money and stand up and say, no, enough is enough. After we stood up, after Robbie filed lawsuits, after we had some wins racked up, then we're calling for weeks and weeks and weeks. Restaurant owners, where are you? What are you doing? Finally, 100 of them got together. Because the ones that got together by themselves, ones that did it on their own, well, they were crushed by the liquor authority. But suddenly, you know, it takes one or two people to stand up like Robbie did with Orchard Park Athletes Unleashed, right?
Yeah.
Stand up and say, no, I'm not going to do this. And what happened? A whole bunch of other people got in behind him and said, yeah, I'm not going to stand up either. And then you get this group together. I'm not going to lay down either. I'm going to stand up and I'm going to fight. And now we're winning, right? It's a huge court case today, a Supreme Court case that Robbie is likely going to win, right? That's awesome. It's going to free up hopefully more restrictions in New York. But that I think that could potentially happen in the Democrat Party. You get more and more people in the assembly that stand up and say no, and you get this growing swell of pressure. And I'm because, again, they're going to fight for their lives. These folks that have – that guy that got threatened by Cuomo, Cuomo's not going to come back around now. He's not going to roll over either. He fights for his life or his political career is destroyed. Yeah. Either he takes out Cuomo and he gets enough people to take him out. Now it's his career or your career. And I think a lot of these Democrats know that, and they don't want to be tied to this guy. I think he goes. I think his time is limited.
As Davis told us, we now have card-carrying David DiPietro has told us there are now card-carrying members in the New York State Assembly of the Communist Party. I don't see it. I hope you're right. My guess is he slowly makes amends with some of these people in the short term. I think the FBI comes in and gives him a clean bill of health because they're as corrupt as he is. And I think they're back on to brighter days. I just don't see it. I will hope you're right. But, I mean, like I said, they haven't even stripped them of his powers yet. I mean, you'd think Democrats and Republicans. Now, the Republicans have gotten together yesterday, actually, and said they wanted to repeal his powers.
Did they find their backbone?
Well,
did
yeah,
they find it? They found it. Yeah, between all of them, they found one.
Many of these Republicans gave him the power. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
A million years.
Why?
I mean, we said that from day one. Like, what are you doing?
It's the easy way out. It's saying, let me take my brain out of my head so I don't have to make hard decisions, and I'll give it to somebody else to make those decisions. Let me tell you something. When the stuff hits the fan, I want to be making the decisions, right?
Well,
I don't want somebody else to tell me get in the lifeboat or don't, right?
The absolute worst time you give somebody like that power is in a crisis, right?
Well,
the worst time, right? I mean, you shouldn't give them power anyways. That's the reason why you were voted in. So there's, you know, balances. But the last thing you do is say, oh, my God, there's a crisis. I don't want my vote in it. Come on. Right. That's ridiculous.
So one more thing before – I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to say Dr. Fauci doesn't answer – if vaccinated grandparents can see grandkids.
Now, some videos to play on that.
There's an easy yes or no answer to this.
The answer is yes.
By the way, you are a mental midget at a totally different level.
Yes.
If you can't see at this point that Dr. Fauci is a communist, that he all as he wants is control.
That's right.
I mean, look at Dr. Fauci. If I'm vaccinated and I'm a grandparent, can I see my grandkids? This is a very easy answer.
Right. Of course
the answer
you can.
Is yes.
The answer is yes. That's right.
Yeah, we're going to go back to living our lives.
That's
you are
right.
now vaccinated. The answer is, by the way, if you've already had COVID, yes, you can see them. very easy. If you can't answer that question, boy, that is scary at a totally different level.
It really is. So this is actually out of the NBC New York. Now, Ben Shapiro wrote just retweeted and said, nope, F off, right? And rightfully so.
Yes.
But the comments are so ridiculous. It's unbelievable. So let me read the article first, okay? This is a tweet from Channel 4 New York, NBC New York. You're fully vaccinated against the coronavirus. Now what? Don't expect to shed your mask and get back to normal activities right away. That's going to be a disappointment, if not a shock, to many people. You know what? I'll say it like Ben Shapiro did. F off, right?
Yeah, I agree.
So here's the comments. This is the best part, right? This is ridiculous. Looking at this tweet and replies, what the hell is wrong with everyone? That's actually a good one. Let's see here. Idiots wearing a mask. Don't wear a mask. Actually, it looks like the intelligent people have actually caught up here.
Yeah, they caught up.
Yeah, because I was reading these earlier. And
I do love that. I do love that.
The intelligent people finally jump in.
Yeah, but
I was reading this earlier this morning, and it was like, you know, Ben, you know, you everyone want people to die, you know, like honest to God, like what? Yeah. What? Like,
no, they never want to go back to normal. They never want to go back to normal now. I mean, what does it take? It's 30 days in a row to build a habit, right? So now we've been at this a year.
Right.
So the habit is now grab your mask and, you know, save the world. And,
this article,
putting a diaper on your face is actually going to get you sicker.
Right. It's ridiculous. In Miami, 81-year-old Naomi Carabolo got her second dose on Tuesday and is looking forward to seeing her friends resuming fitness classes and running errands after nearly a year of being extremely cautious, even ordering groceries online. Her line is, quote, I'm tired of talking to the cats and the parrots, said her daughter Susan.
She
wants to do things and talk to people. Of course she does. She's 81 years old.
Sure.
Do you know what she's been through?
Right.
You know? I mean, come on.
Out of her.
Right? But the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention hasn't yet changed its guidelines.
Oh,
do we have no common sense whatsoever?
None
whatsoever? Are people this stupid? Yes, they are is the answer.
Yes,
the answer
they are.
Is yes. Don't answer that. It's rhetorical. Unbelievable. It really is.
Want to play the video?
Yeah, let's play a video. This is really good, actually. These are a couple of videos here that I'm going to play, bookmarks. This is a bit older, but I think it's important. This guy is a California guy, okay? This guy is a clinical lab scientist in virology. Whoops, hang on a second. Whoa, you're starting without me, buddy. In virology and something else here. Wait, hang on a second. Clinical lab scientist in virology and immunology scans 1,500 California COVID-19 positive lab samples with an electron microscope, and guess what he finds? Zero COVID. Let me play this video.
19 samples collected in virology and immunology. I'm a clinical lab scientist and have tested 1,500 supposed positive COVID-19 samples collected here in Southern California. When my lab team and I did the testing through Koch's postulates and observation under a scanning electron microscope, we found no COVID in any of the 1,500 samples. What we found was that all of the 1,500 samples were mostly influenza A and some were influenza B, but not a single case of COVID, and we did not use the BSPCR test. It's polymerase chain reaction test. Celia Farber does wonderful journalism on the topic. I did videos on this channel for that. We then sent the remainder of the samples to Stanford, Cornell, and a few of the University of California labs, and they found the same results as we did. No COVID. They found influenza A and B. All of us then spoke to the CDC and asked for viable samples of COVID, which CDC said they could not provide as they did not have any samples. We have now come to the firm conclusion through all our research and lab work that the COVID-19 was imaginary and fictitious. Oof. The flu was called COVID, and most of the 225,000 dead were dead through comorbidities such as heart disease, cancer, diabetes, emphysema, et cetera.
Yeah.
Then they got the flu, which further weakened their immune systems, and they died. I have yet to find a single viable sample of COVID-19 to work with. We at the seven universities that did the lab tests on these 1,500 samples are now suing the CDC for COVID-19 fraud. The CDC has yet to send us a single viable, isolated, purified sample of COVID-19. Wow. If they can't or won't send us a viable sample, I say they're D.
This is exactly what I said before, right? Exactly what, when we were having the conversation about, you know, well, this looks like it's a little more infectious. And
yeah.
I've said it's less infectious, right? If we had monitored the flu 2 years ago, like we're doing with COVID, millions of people would have died with the flu.
Right.
80,000 people died of the flu 2 years ago.
Right.
It was worse than COVID.
Well,
80,000 people have not died of COVID.
But let me ask you this, though. If we had counted every death as the flu
right.
in 2018,
right.
how many
millions.
More
millions.
Would there really be?
Millions.
Right? Because to his point, like your point, right, most of these people, sadly, now some, look at my 93-year-old great aunt suffered a stroke. We talked about this a couple weeks ago, sadly, right?
Yeah.
She's now in a nursing home. She went to the hospital, then to the care facility,
yeah.
where she got COVID, right?
The flu. We'll call it. We should call it the flu.
She has survived.
Right.
Okay, so now a couple weeks has gone by. She has essentially survived. At least I hope she survived it because they sent her into the nursing home.
Right.
I would hope that they would learn their lesson in New York by now and not send somebody who's still contagious. So I'm assuming that she's no longer contagious because they have sent her now into a nursing home, okay?
Yeah.
She's 93 years old. Now, if she passes away, it will be from the stroke. Here's the thing, though. Here's what they've said. This is something the CDC did change. No one's talking about. They, first of all, and this is where Donald Trump failed with Dr. Birx, right?
Yep.
Dr. Birx said, well, if you die of something else, like, I don't know, a head-on car crash, or maybe a suicide, gunshot to the head. But George Floyd, you had COVID at the time. We're counting as COVID.
We're not looking backwards, by the way.
But they've taken
we've said this multiple times over the last year.
Oh, yes.
Multiple times. I remember screaming, Donald Trump, get the messaging right.
Yep.
You actually talked to people in his administration to tell him to get the administration.
I blasted one somebody in the administration and said, what are you guys doing? He goes, well, this is not the hill to die on. Well, it never is, right?
No.
Which is it? Because we just lost it. We lost
they
everything, right?
It. Yep.
Anyway, so what was I saying? Now, the flu, let's make a point there.
The numbers are false.
So the flu, right? We have no idea. Oh. So CDC, they changed their guidance about 2 months ago. 2 months ago, they changed their guidance. Nobody's paid attention to this. Now they're saying not just if you died of something else, but had COVID at the time of death. Now what they're saying is if we look back at your history and you tested positive any time in the previous 30 days, we're counting it as COVID. So you get COVID. You survive. Let's say my aunt. We'll use that as an example, right? My great aunt. She had a stroke, which is probably what will eventually kill her, of course, sadly. She wasted her last year of her life because she was unable to go out hiding, unfortunately, right? So she's now recovered, right? She's now recovered from COVID. If she passes away from, let's say she falls, slips, and cracks her head open. Okay, just something fluke, right?
Yep.
But she had COVID in the last 30 days. They're going to count that as COVID. Would have nothing to do with COVID whatsoever. Zero. But they'll still count it. So the sad thing is we don't have any idea. We have no idea. And here's the other thing is we're counting cumulative. If you went back and said, okay, well, last 10 years, over half a million people have died in this country alone from the flu.
If we counted it this way, it would have been millions and millions of people that died with the flu.
Exactly.
Yeah. It is the biggest scam in global history. Yep. And this is not me looking backwards. I said this from week one. You guys can go back and pull the podcast, the radio show. I called bullshit on this right away.
Let's play the rest of this clip, then I got another one to play. This guy's good, though.
Now suing the CDC for COVID-19 fraud. The CDC has yet to send us a single viable, isolated, purified sample of COVID-19. If they can't or won't send us a viable sample, I say there is no COVID-19. It is fictitious. The four research papers that do describe the genomic extracts of the COVID-19 virus never were successful in isolating and purifying the samples. All the four papers written on COVID-19 only describe small bits of RNA, which were only 37 to 40 base pairs long, which is not a virus.
So
this guy better get security, by the way.
This guy, by the
Somebody
way.
He better call him and let him know that he needs his own security
but
team
here's the thing.
He better know who they are.
He's not the only one, right? He's not. There are, like you might say, wow, it's just one guy on the internet. Look at thousands and thousands and thousands of doctors, of virologists, of immunology specialists, of infectious disease specialists. Yeah. We listen to one guy, a 40-year useless bureaucrat. 40-year useless bureaucrat. I would take an academic over a bureaucrat any day.
Yeah. Academics were 96% wrong, too. What we should have done, to your point, is, and we've said this, and we're the only ones that interviewed, frontline COVID doctors, right? There was hundreds of them on the step of Washington.
That's right.
And I said that day, and so did you. Yeah. Look, Donald Trump.
They shut it right
these
down.
These are the people that should be on your press conference every goddamn day.
Give
That's
them,
where he failed.
Yes.
He failed miserably. He fell right into their trap. And we called
Because he
it.
Had people that were telling him, this is not the hill to die on, Mr. President.
Not the hill to die on.
Don't pick this battle, Mr. President. It was the hill
to
die on.
How about it's always the hill of the die on when you're being honest with the American people.
Absolutely.
Honesty
That's
would
right.
have been, look at, you know, interviewing that frontline COVID doctor out of Chicago who said she started to use
Z-Pak and hydroxychloroquine.
Yeah. And she had over 300 patients, every single one of them walking out of the hospital. Dr. Erickson, a frontline COVID doctor, who said there's going to be a high case count in this, very low death count. It is the normal flu. That's who I would have interviewed. Not Dr. Fauci, who never met with anybody, who was miraculously on a baseball mound with a mask on, but yet caught in the stands with his family.
How about
with the mask off?
How about when he's in Congress? He's testifying in the floor of Congress. Cameras are on, mask is up. As soon as the cameras go,
he takes the camera off.
he takes the mask right off. He's with the mask off.
A joke.
Folks, we've seen this in press conferences. We've seen this in White House meetings, right? We've seen this with the press, right? They all have their masks on. As soon as the cameras, they think the cameras are off, the masks come off.
We've seen
the
it masks with left-wing are bullshit, liberals that total are attacking bullshit. Us locally, and then we catch them all hanging out, drinking champagne.
Absolutely. Around the bonfire with Democrat friends. Yes.
Yeah, 20
the great?
Of them together holding arms, holding hands.
They lecture like polling cars. They lecture everybody else, right? Yep. And, it's a 10-minute rule. Oh, I was just with my mates. Oh, I just wanted to play hockey. Oh, I just had the golf, right? It's okay for you because you don't want to be inconvenienced while you're controlling everybody
celebrating
else.
Celebrating the Biden victory, maskless with my
maskless,
buddies.
That's right. Here's another video, by the way. This is attached to the existing video. Different guy, different doctor, same basic thought process.
If I was speaking to a live audience, I would say to the audience, Anybody take a guess as to how many people right now in the medical literature have been positively identified with COVID-19, having the exact same set of symptoms, or at least very similar, who've had the virus isolated, purified, characterized, found a unique segment so that we actually have a gold standard? And I think everybody by now knows, I know the exact answer to that question. I know the exact number. It's zero. Therefore, because there is nothing to compare this PCR test to, not even one person, you can't say that it's 10%, 14%, or 84.6, or any percent. In other words, and if there's anything I want everybody to take away from this short video, there is no such thing as a false positive PCR test for coronavirus, nor is there a such thing as a false negative test for coronavirus with a PCR test. The test is not false positive. It's not false negative. It's just plain good old-fashioned false. It means nothing, because unless you have a gold standard, you have no idea what you're testing for.
Yeah.
Unless you've isolated the virus, sequenced the genome, found a unique segment, which has not been done, you have no idea whether you're testing for segments that come from this virus or not. The test is meaningless, which is why it's such a dangerous weapon, because you can make the test positive or not, just depending on how many cycles you amplify the sequences, and that becomes a horrible weapon for controlling the numbers in a so-called pandemic.
Wow. Exactly. He nails it, too. Let me say this. You might wonder, and we talked a little bit about this on Saturday's show, the numbers for the positive cases are suddenly, in the last 3 weeks, have plummeted.
Plummeted.
About 74% or 75%.
You remember us doing a show a few weeks ago, though, about them actually changing the way they test.
Well, is that it, though? So one of two things has to be true, right? One of two things must be the case, right? Either they've changed the test, which may be the case. It could be that they've turned down the test or whatever. Yeah. But this guy's saying they're all false anyway, so don't bother.
False anyways,
right? So that could be. But
I would believe the frontline doctor. Well, sure. Everybody,
that very well could be. For those that are the conspiracy theorists out there, you probably will. You'll lean in that camp, right? You'll say, well, they turned down the test. That could be the case. Right. Here's the other theory, though, and this came out of a who was it? Who does the? Huge college.
Part of the way they were factoring in positives was, number one, if you stepped out of line, you became a positive.
Well, that's true, too. Yeah, they
did contract tracing with some of these folks that they paid. And if you were even near somebody, you were counted as a positive, even though you're very high.
It's a lot like the election results. Yeah. Threw it in the mix, right?
Yeah, Joe was going to vote Democrat. Right. He didn't show up.
Yeah, he didn't show up. So we just took, we just took care of it for him.
Just assumed.
Very similar. Very, very similar. Absolutely.
Yeah, just drop him off at 4 a.m. Nobody will know. Yeah.
So the second thing is, and I can't remember what university it was, whatever the university that's been doing
it.
John Hopkins. Thank you very much. Yep. The John Hopkins professor came out and said, we are heading, and there was a whole Wall Street Journal article editorial on
herd immunity by April.
Herd immunity by April, right? So could that be the case that suddenly because it can't be the vaccine. Not enough people are vaccinated yet to account for those numbers.
Not even close.
It likely is actually herd immunity, right?
Yeah.
So what are they doing right now? We have things that have plummeted 75%, right? Numbers have plummeted 75%. Why now do you think they're pushing this double mask garbage?
Yeah.
Why do you think now?
Save the day, right? We saved the day.
Because they can't use the argument that mask. Yeah. Somebody said this to me.
Well, they can't use the argument that Joe Biden did anything because he has said himself, I can't change the trajectory. I'll get it out. Of COVID, right? Before the election, he said he's got a whole plan. He's going to wipe this thing out. After the election, not so much. I can't do anything with it. I'm really sorry about it.
Well, mark my words.
Now he goes, I got a plan for the vaccine. You can't even spell
that. No. Mark my words, though. It'll be about 3 weeks from now. Three weeks from now, what they're going to say is they're going to look back and say, see, we all have to wear double masks because the wearing of double masks are what impacted the COVID numbers and helped us drive down the numbers so much.
Yeah.
And thank you to President Biden for having the fortitude to suggest that we have at least a mask, if not a double mask. That'll be what the narrative will be in the mainstream. mainstream media.
No doubt.
Because they can't account for it any other way, right?
No.
They're caught now in the lie that masks work. Because
they were caught in the lie somebody, of this whole thing from day one, right?
But somebody said to me.
You look at the liberals like Cuomo, who kept doubling up and doubling up.
Yeah, but
I know the infection rate in gyms is only 0.6.
Right.
And I know you being forced in your house is 75%, but I'm going to double up, triple up those gyms.
I'm
going
to double down on it and continue. So somebody said to me recently, well, that just goes to show the masks are working. I'm like, no.
No.
Because if that were the case, then wouldn't the masks have worked in September?
Well, think about
why didn't the mask work in July? How about in March?
Why not last March? I mean, literally, in last March, it was like a bomb dropped, right?
Yeah.
People were stuck in their house. Yeah. They were scared to go anywhere. There was a few people who, it's April, May started to open up, and they said, look, I've had enough of it. But literally, if the mask work, it should have wiped this whole thing out. Remember, 2 weeks to slow the curve, right?
Yeah.
That's what we were told. Put your mask on, stay in your house, 2 weeks to slow the curve. Well, that anniversary is coming on, right?
Yeah, so we're coming up
on
a year.
The masks have done nothing but make people sicker. That's all they've done. They've made people sicker.
Well, the thing is that they have no explanation outside. The herd immunity is likely the case, right?
Herd immunity.
This will likely be
mutation of it, right? We continue to hear about the mutation of it. And the only thing the media can ever do, remember, the mainstream media has been 94% negative on this.
Yeah.
The only thing we hear about mutations is, oh my gosh, there's another variant coming out of Africa. There's another. Well, what about it mutating itself away? What about it burning itself out? Had we let the kids go back to school with a 0% chance of dying, right? We're going to lose way more kids from anxiety, suicide, depression than we will by locking them in and hiding them from a flu that they had a 0% chance of. They would have burned this thing out months and months and months ago, and they would have been immune to it for the rest of their lives. So when they are 95 and their body sees COVID-19, they go, yeah, I already saw it. It's so old news. I'm not going to get sick from it. Instead, we put diapers on these kids' faces and said, well, we think that's going to help your immune system. And then, of course, the flu just kept going and going.
So look out for this coming next, okay? What's coming next, folks, is we have to get to zero COVID. That's going to be the next mantra.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I swear to God, right? It's going to be, well, yes, things are down 75%, but now we're going to strive for zero. And this, out of Ireland, actually, leaked documents show that members of the Zero COVID Advocacy Group, whose public-facing campaign is We Can Be Zero, were recently instructed to, quote, look for ways to increase insecurity, anxiety, and uncertainty.
That's
okay.
Scary.
Let me read a little bit more of this article because this is ridiculous, right?
By the way, they think, again, you're not going to change the trajectory of a flu. You are not going to do
that. But they want
to
panic
people.
It's
going to find you if you think, unless you're going to sit in your house and starve to death and not touch a single thing. And I assure you, if you don't touch stuff, your immune system is going to be so messed up, it's not even funny. You will die of multiple things, and COVID probably won't be one of them.
So this is out of Grip. This is an overseas publication. The revelation comes from a trove of hundreds of emails, draft documents, and ISAG internal communications that were recently leaked to Grip. ISAG members were instructed to review and internalize instructions to look for ways to increase insecurity, anxiety, and uncertainty, and to go after people and not institutions because, quote, people hurt faster than institutions. The instructions were shared to the group by Professor Anthony Staines, pretty good name for him, I guess, one of the founders of ISAG, in a note titled Notes from 2020 2 of 08, ISAG meeting. The note reminded ISAG members of the importance of ridicule as man's most powerful weapon and that the threat of a thing is usually more terrifying than the thing itself.
Sure.
ISAG members, many of whom are regular guests in Irish media, were told that they could count on imagination to dream up many more consequences than they themselves, as the threat is usually more terrifying than the thing itself. These instructions are based on Saul Alinsky's book, Rules for Radicals, which argues that the creation of conflict is necessary for activists to succeed and that organizers should find or create an enemy who can be singled out, personally blamed for everything that has gone wrong, and attacked and ridiculed unmercifully, regardless of the chosen enemy actually bears any responsibility for the thing you are blaming him for. The book tells organizers to allow no middle ground. Wow, isn't that interesting? Why would they do that, do you think? Why would they want a constant panic? It's just amazing, right?
Well, because it worked.
It worked.
And you still have many conservatives who don't believe in any of this. Not that we don't believe in it, but don't believe in how this was handled. But yet you're still putting their mask on. They're not fighting. They're not showing up to support restaurant owners in the fight to end this, right? Robbie's Gym in Orchard Park should be overwhelmed with new conservative members that say, I want to work out in a place that doesn't force me to wear a mask every single day. They're still hiding. The control... Yeah. has been real. They've been successful with it.
It's the propaganda.
Has been, and it's been real, and they've been able to control people and manipulate people, and they've won. And they've won. They won the election out of it. Big part of winning the election. I know there's the thought behind part of this is cheating. The other part of it that Donald Trump lost the war on COVID. He lost the communication part of it. 500,000 people did not die of COVID. They died with COVID. That's a very big deal. Now we're finding out that they might not have even died with COVID. It might have been the normal flu all along, which is something that we talked about months ago.
Yep.
It's like COVID-19 is no different than COVID-18 or COVID-17 or the flus before that. The numbers don't support it. It's a bunch of BS.
Yep. That's basically
I know we're up against the clock here.
So one, a couple more things real quick. You'll love this, Mike. In New York City, North Manhattan, they're no longer going to send police officers to domestic violence and mental health issues. They're going to send in the social workers. How do you think that's going to go?
Now, how many social workers need to get killed before that ends?
Right.
Yeah. That will not end well, by the way.
Exactly. That's exactly what I tweeted, by the way. This is not going to end well.
God bless you social workers if you actually have the stones to go in, but my guess is they won't. Yeah. There's a reason why social workers are social workers and police officers are police officers. And my guess is these social workers are not going to not going to end up in too many homes.
That's exactly what I tweeted. This won't end well. The NYPD will stay out of any mental health crisis calls, and social workers will respond instead in parts of northern Manhattan starting this spring, according to the Associated Press. Good luck with that.
Good luck.
By the way, if you want to follow us on social media, we are very active on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, and more. You can go to our website at thefinancialguys.com, thefinancialguys.com. You'll find all the links to everything that we do. We do have a Parler account. We're starting to use that more and more as we're coming back online. We do have a Gab account. As soon as I figure out what the password is, I can get in there and actually do some gabbing, I guess. We're going to continue to look for alternative platforms as well. Don't forget our YouTube channel, and we will probably set up a, it's not YouTube, but there's something else out there that's kind of like it. We'll probably set up a link there too. You know, we assume, like everybody else, that we're going to get chased off of social media. We're going to get chased off to LinkedIn. We'll be shut down on Facebook. The social media titans, by the way, are getting more aggressive with that. So not only did we lose a lot of followers on Twitter as people got wiped off of Twitter, we lost a lot of people we were following. I was following like 1,600 great people. All of a sudden, they took 200 of those people away, which is ridiculous.
There's no negative. There's nobody that's, you know.
It's the propaganda, though, and the way that they control the media is honest to God, it's Goebbels would be proud.
But
right?
I saw Bill Gates was asked about the other day. He goes, well, you know, you can't probably shouldn't ban Trump for life. But the right answer is just because you don't agree with them doesn't mean you wipe them off of a platform, right? Just because, but they've done that with TV, right? They've done it with TV.
Yep.
Even Fox now is what a pitiful discussion. I mean, outside of Tucker,
it turns out that one of those kids donated like $500,000 to a fake left wing media outlet while chastising conservatives for false news and fake media. He's literally donating to a propaganda fake media site. This is your Fox News owners now, folks. That's pretty sickening. It really is. Anyway,
the TV has already done that. We saw locally here at the Sunny Broken Record, they lied about Stefan Mihailo. And I'll say they lied because they did zero investigative reporting to see if he was actually at work. They said, oh, he's not at work because he didn't swipe his time card to come in.
Garbage reporting.
To come in the building. But yet never found out if the rest of the entire building did the same thing, because had he done that, this reporter at Channel 7, Charlie Speck, he would have found out that everybody would have looked like nobody was at work because everybody's coming in and out of the building, multiple people at the same time.
Right.
We were able to prove on camera that Stefan was there. Never did he send an apology.
Not a retraction. I would have demanded a retraction if I was Stefan.
I would have sued him.
James O'Keefe has been doing at Project Veritas.
Good.
So every time there's a false report, he goes after him legally and he forces a retraction. He's got a whole wall of shame of all the retractions he's been able to get.
They don't care. They don't care. It's the theory Nancy Pelosi developed a long time ago. Throw it out. People think that.
The wrap-up smear.
These people are too stupid to go find the truth, which is really true. The Democrats don't care. They'll just eat on it and feed on it like parasites. So.
Yep.
And of course, no apology, no nothing. Oh, really? I lied. Well, I guess I move on. Yeah. Let's go on to the next story that I can lie about.
Yep. Yeah. Here's Pelosi explaining how this works. Well, of course, we've got to have an ad first. God forbid. Stupid YouTube. This is Nancy Pelosi in her own words. I love this. This is exactly what they do, though.
In tonight's Fact or Fiction, we're answering another viewer question. Chris Brown from Oceans.
You smear somebody with falsehoods and all the rest, and then you merchandise it. And then you write it, and they'll say, see, it's reported in the press that this, 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 and this. So they have that validation that the press...
So that's what they did.
That's exactly what Charlie said.
What happened was somebody, and that's a friend of Poland Cars, leaked information to Channel 7, which was not correct, right? They got the information, obviously, from Mark, right? So they leaked the information to Channel 7. Channel 7 runs with it, and then Mark Poland Cars can use that, and the Democrats can use that to say, see, I'm not saying it. It's Channel 7 did this investigative report, right?
Yep.
Charlie, be a man, issue a retraction, please, right? Yeah. Seriously, you were wrong. You can admit that, right? You did a bad job. Issue a retraction. He deserves that. But that's what they do, folks. They throw it out there, right?
Yep.
So I thought a false accusation. You heard it. They throw out a false accusation. Then we get the media to pick it up, right? And then we use that media as validation, and we call that a wrap-up smear. And that's exactly what they're doing on a regular basis, right? They should do this with Cuomo because there's really, you don't have to make stuff up. You could just actually do reporting and you'd find out that he needs to go to jail.
By the way, that's what the lawyers are doing. They're winning these lawsuits with his own words. Here's his math. Here's his science. And the judges, many of them Democrat, by the way, are going, oh, yeah, I guess the science is right, but he's just not following it. Let's open up. Yeah.
Let's end on this.
I will say, though, we have to get to the point where these masks go away.
Well,
for you that say, oh, for the folks that say it's not a big deal.
It is a big deal.
Ask the restaurant owners how their business is with people going in with a diaper on their face.
Well, it is a big deal. It's a big deal because it's not normal, okay? You're not socializing. And I said before, I've lost a good chunk of my hearing from playing drums and shooting guns for many, many years. Right now, I wear ear protection now, but when you're young, you're stupid, right? And and of course, when you're hunting, you don't always wear ear protection because you won't be able to hear the animals, the ducks, or whatever you're trying to listen for, right? So, for me, not being able to see somebody's lips. I won't even talk to you. If you're wearing a mask and you think you're going to have a conversation with me,
it's so unsocial.
Don't even bother.
It's so unhealthy.
I don't understand what you're saying. But here's what I hear. I just want to tell you. This is what I hear seriously, when you're talking through a mask, I hear this. Because I don't hear well to begin with. So for me, reading your lips and seeing what you're saying and how your mouth is pronouncing things helps me a tremendous amount to really understand. Not to mention just having a barrier between your face is blocking what you're saying, right? It's so stupid. Yeah. And I love these press conferences, right? You know damn well, as soon as they step off the podium, they take the damn mask off, right?
Oh, absolutely.
But they put the mask on for the camera. Nobody is anywhere near 6 to 10 feet away from them. Right. Oftentimes, there's nobody anywhere close to them. Right. And they put the mask on so they can listen to the press conference. It's called virtue signaling, folks. I'm watching people put a mask on by themselves, look around to see who's looking so they can see, look at me. I'm a good liberal. Look at me. Right.
Yep.
Ridiculous.
Yep.
All right. One last thing, and then we'll wrap this up. You need to throughout the week, folks. We do manage money for a living. Call us at the office, 833-FIN-GUYS. Or again, go to our website, thefinancialguys.com. Share this stuff. If you like what you saw or you like what you listened to on Facebook, give us a thumbs up. Doesn't cost you anything. Hit the subscribe button. You'll get notified anytime something new comes out. And if you're downloading this and listening to us on the podcast, give us a review. That helps us out a lot as well. One last thing, Mike. This is from the government always does things better and cheaper, according to liberals. You'll never guess. California's bullet train cost savings backfire. Cost savings, please. As project speeds past $100 billion.
Unreal.
They budgeted about $3 billion for this thing, folks, is what their original projections were.
Wow.
They are now at $100 billion. They changed
that
to $33 billion.
How could that be possible? How could you be that off?
Yes.
Even a government agency.
Totally
how
useless.
How could you be that
because
incompetent?
Because unions is a big part of it. Because in New York City,
well,
if
like
you remember.
Like the skating rink in New York City,
But no, remember the subway track. It was $1 million a foot.
Yeah.
A foot, $1 million for every foot of track, right? Here's the article. This is from the Washington Examiner. L.A. to San Francisco high-speed rail system, pitched as one of the biggest public work projects in the nation, was supposed to cost $33 billion and be operational by 2020. Originally, it was supposed to cost $3 to $5 billion. That was the original estimates. They raised that to $33 billion, and it was supposed to be operational by 2020. Okay. As of 2021, the price tag has topped $100 billion, and it doesn't even have a start date. This thing will we're going to dump $100 billion in this thing, and it will never be operational. And if it gets operational, there's not going to be anybody left in California to ride the damn thing. Unbelievable.
Well, they won't be able to unless you get a diaper on your face and a negative COVID test.
Instead of L.A. to San Francisco, it should be L.A. and San Francisco right to Texas and Nevada. Because if you want people to ride the train, ride it out. Right?
Yeah, with big cargo, you know, things in the back so they could just pack their stuff. Yeah, that's
hilarious.
Exactly right.
All right, that's going to do it for us. But that you can't make this stuff up, folks. No. This is your government dollars at work, which is why we advocate for smaller government, more private sector, more free market capital. If you were to give that project to Elon Musk, honestly, he'd been done by now at one-third of the price. No question, right?
Certainly Trump would have had it done. Right, he did that. Should prove that with the ice rinks in New York City, where they were way, way, way over budget.
7 years they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it.
Under budget and actually got the project completed.
They couldn't even do it. They came up with a scheme that it didn't work. None of it worked. It was a total disaster. Trump came and got it done in 7 months under budget for free. He did it for free. You know why he did it for free? Because he loves America and he loves New York. That's why. Yep. Even though you liberals hate him back. So guess what? Palm Beach will get his money going forward, not New York City, as well as the whole family. Nice job. Way to go, New York. Anyway, all right. That's going to do it for us, folks. Again, if you need us throughout the week, go to our website, thefinancialguys.com. Call us at the office, 833-FIN-GUYS. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. We appreciate it. On behalf of Mike Lomas, I'm Glenn Wiggle. We are the Financial Guys. We'll see you on Saturday for the Financial Guys radio show.